And welcome back to RTOD. Today we're talking about two things that usually cause heated conversation in the retro computing and electronic circles, and that's retapping. First, let's start off with RIFA capacitors and set the record straight. These are really called safety filtering capacitors. RIFA, or really Evox RIFA, is a brand name. Today, a company called Kenner owns that. They bought out Evox RIFA. However, due to the high amount of RIFA-branded safety filtering capacitors failing, we often hear these just called RIFA caps. If you look in any forum, say, oh, I gotta replace my RIFAs, or my RIFAs failed. This is similar to saying Kleenex, Xerox, or Google. These are company names that have been associated with their function so much that we say Xerox it, vice copy it. Or we'll say, hey, go Google this when we want somebody to look it up, even if they're not using Google. In the long term, this can lead to a loss of trademark, but that's a topic for another day. Safety filtering capacitors come in two classes, X and Y. So let's draw this out and we'll talk about each of them. Over here, we're going to have a load. Line and neutral AC. Just demonstration purposes, we wouldn't have a class X and a Y installed like this in this similar fashion, but it's just for demonstration. Class X capacitors are called line to line. They're fitted between line and neutral. Typically, these are used where a failure could cause a fire, because when they fail, they will cause this circuit to open. The breaker will trip, the fuse will blow. Class Y capacitors are line to ground. And they're fitted between, like I said, line and ground. As you can assume, these are installed in where a failure would prevent a shock to a user. So this protects the user, this will protect the equipment, and ultimately the user. When a RIFA fails, see, I'm even calling it, when a safety capacitor fails, you usually hear a loud pop and there will be a lot of smoke. Because on the RIFA design, this plastic shield gets cracked. Moisture gets in there over a period of time, and eventually it will pop and we'll have a lot of smoke come out. Users typically, they get scared, rightfully so, because their vintage computer, it looks like it's on fire. It's not. They'll unplug it, and more often than not, they might throw it away. They don't realize that this can be fixed or even used without it. You can substitute a Y for an X class, but never an X for a Y class. I highly recommend trying to find the exact same one that was in there previously, but if you need to substitute, you can. These also serve to filter out noise. If you're of a certain age, you might remember watching TV and having a running vacuum or a blender causing that TV to go all wonky because there's noise in the line. This has gotten better. This was like an 80s, a 90s thing. As standards were raised, electronic filtering got better, and now we can run a vacuum in the same room as your old TV, and you probably won't have that issue anymore. So are these needed today? In an industrial application, 100% yes. If it's some big metal cabinet doing very crucial work and you want to ensure the safety of your employees and other equipment in there, yes. In vintage consumer items, maybe. As you could tell, looking at these drawings, even if we take out one of these are not required for the device to function in 99.9% of the cases. I know people who have ran Apple IIe's for years with the filtering cap removed. That's fine. Personally, I don't find replacing these hard, and I don't mind it. I kind of enjoy it. So I always replace these, and sometimes, a lot of times, I do it preventively. I replace it before it fails because I don't want the smoke. I don't want the smell. I don't want all of those bad things to happen with my electronic devices. So I highly, highly recommend replacing these. Having strips of various standards is helpful, and you can go and replace things as you come and go in your collection. Like I said before, home electrical interference like we had in the 80s and early 90s is almost eliminated. So they're not as obviously needed. but they can protect your device if something were to go haywire. And in all honesty, I mean, I'm kind of a purist when it comes to a lot of my electronics. I like to have it almost stock. Now, mind you, I use Raspberry Pis and other emulators and everything, but I try to keep things as stock as much as I can. So, yeah, replace them, put them in. It's better for you. It's better for your equipment. And at the end of the day, it's really not going to harm anything. And these are really cheap anyway. So that leads us to capacitors, typically electrolytic capacitors. Go onto your favorite Facebook, Reddit, Discord, anything about vintage computers and electronics, especially audiophiles, and I guarantee you'll see a recent thread on recapping. So that's where we take the existing capacitors in a device and replace them with newer ones. Assuming you have the skills and equipment to replace these, should you? Well, if you have an apparent leak and you see, you know, damage to the board, absolutely. If your device is not powering on and you did all the dummy troubleshooting, hey, are we getting power? Where's the power on the hot side? You know, sure, do it. I think we can all agree on these two points. Given the skills and equipment and you've done all the dummy checks, sure, replace them, especially if they're leaking. Where we may disagree is, do I replace all of them or do I replace C90 because I know that one is leaking? Well, personally, unless there's an outrageous number of capacitors, there was a Sony TV I was working on that had just dozens and dozens and dozens of these things that were in very various locations, some harder to get to than others. I'm not going to replace all of those. If it's not an outrageous number and they're relatively accessible, yeah, I'm going to replace all of them. Personally, it's not that cumbersome, and I kind of enjoy it, you know. And if it's a device that I've already torn apart and I'm inside and I'm working on it, let's just knock out all the preventive maintenance at once. Let's replace all the caps. Let's clean it. Let's do all the dummy check on there. Replace anything else that can be worn out, thermal pastes, whatever it is. Let's get it all done. And there's a reason I say that. Now, this isn't going to be on the test, so you don't have to memorize this, but this is a formula for life expectancy of capacitors in hours. Like everything, there is an estimated life expectancy of it. And the reason I'm showing you this, and this is a lot of gobbledygook, let's be honest, right? The life in hours varies on a lot of things. What is the life of that capacitor at a rated temperature? What is the max rated temp? And we can get all these on the spec sheets for the capacitor. Sometimes it even says on the side, you know, hey, this max is 85°C. All right, so we know that, great. What the variable is T₁ or ambient temperature. What is the ambient temperature that this device is operating in? And that is what concerns me the most because, hey, this Commodore 64, I've only had this one for about a year. I have no idea where this was for the rest of its life. You know, was it stored in an attic where there were huge temperature fluctuations? Was it, you know, on for 10 years at a time and in a heated room? You know, we don't know. We don't know the life cycle of capacitors. And by looking at them, you really don't know, you know, how much life is left on it. And sure, we can remove it and we can test it to make sure it's still in spec. But to me, it's just easier to replace it all. That's why I'm showing you this. You know, there is an accepted formula to show the life expectancy of it. But there's just a lot of variables to know how much life is left in this guy. Is it even working correctly? So personally, I replace them most of the time. And I really try to replace them with higher quality capacitors than were what installed. You have to understand, companies like this, when they're, you know, banging out hundreds of thousands of units, they're trying to lower the cost and they're going to use the cheapest, most efficient components at the time. And, you know, let's be honest, was or, you know, anybody involved in any of these old computers really thinking that 20, 30, 40 years down the road, people are still going to be using them? Probably not, right? Even then, there was still a disposable mindset, but, it was always on to the next bigger thing. So let's pump these out. Let's get them to the consumer, work on the replacement. So try to use better stuff in there. Right now, I'm on a Worth Electronics kick. I like their red capacitors. I think they look cool. I've heard that they're a little higher quality. I haven't done any personal testing for it, but I know a lot of audiophiles like Worth, and that's not a gauge of quality by any means, but, you know, take it for what it is. So remember, when you're sourcing capacitors for a project, the capacitance should be the same. Voltage can be higher, all right? The voltage rating on a capacitance is its upper, or voltage rating on a capacitor is its upper limit. The capacitance needs to stay the same in what the original one is there. More often than not, if you buy a capacitor kit from any reputable retailer, all the variables are the same or known accepted values. If you're going on your own to source them, just pay attention to the values. Make sure you get it. Rarely will you not find the same values in a lot of these components. There might be one or two caps of a really weird value that you might find something at a higher voltage, or you just might not find it at all. And there's a lot of resources out there to help you with recapping questions. So keep the capacitance the same, and remember to keep your polarity the same. Capacitors do have a positive and negative side. Make sure you install them the same way that they originally were. So that's going to wrap up this video. What do you think? Do you replace all your safety or RIFA capacitors? Do you just recap every system you get? What are your variables? How do you know when you need to replace these things? Do you replace them, or do you just run it as is? Let me know in the comments. And thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.